Welcome to London First Baptist Youth Ministry. We are still not together, so we're doing this online again. So watch it with us tonight on Instagram or later on Instagram and Facebook and YouTube. We are continuing a study in Colossians. We started it last week. It's kind of the finishing touches on something we started going through Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, and Colossians called Basic Instructions. And so tonight, we're going to look at Colossians 1, 15 through 29. And I've called tonight, Give Me Jesus. It looks at the story of Jesus, the Christology of Jesus, as Paul writes it in Colossians chapter 1. So while you're turning over there, I want to tell you guys a story. Back in 1893, at the World's Columbian Exposition, it was held in Chicago, D.L. Moody, the great preacher, saw an opportunity to preach the gospel among the exhibits and among the 21 million people who were going to be at this particular event. And people wanted him to stand against other religions and other philosophies and stuff like that. But he said instead, I'm going to make Jesus Christ so attractive that men will turn to him. And it wound up being the greatest evangelistic work of this great man's life, of this great evangelist's life. Thousands of people came to know Christ. The writer T.S. Eliot once said, Jesus is the still point of a turning world. Jesus is the still point of a turning world. Abraham Kuyper, who was a pastor, a theologian, a philosopher, a journalist, politician, all these different things, he stated there is not a square inch in the whole domain of our human existence over which Christ, who is sovereign over all, does not cry, mine. It all belongs to him. Even non-believer H.G. Wells, the great author, said this, I am an historian, I am not a believer, but this penniless preacher from Nazareth is irrevocably the very center of history. So all these people recognized Jesus and recognized who he is and how great he was and his work and his greatness throughout history. And so we're going to talk about this tonight. The universe doesn't make any sense without Christ. Paul spends a bunch of verses talking about the supremacy of Christ, the creator, the sustainer of all things. Paul used a lot of universals. He said all and whole and every and things like that a lot. He claims a lot of things as absolutes. And to the modern ears, Colossians sounds ludicrous at best, offensive at worst, because of its exclusive claims about Christ. And so in this passage that we're going to look at tonight, these verses at the end of Colossians chapter 1, we see Paul's Christology. We see one of his finest sequences of looking at the theology of who Jesus Christ is. So let's look at Colossians chapter 1, if I can get over there. Verses 15 through 29. I'm going to read a little bit and stop kind of as we go. Verse 15, and then I'm going to read verse 19 because I think the two tie together. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. And then in verse 19, for God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him. So the word used here is eikon, the Greek word icon, where we get our English word icon, which is an image, a representation, a picture of something. Jesus is the exact visible picture, the exact visible representation of God. He makes visible the invisible God that people knew about in the Old Testament. If you know Jesus, you get to know God. The Son is the truest representation of God. So Jesus represents the invisible God of the Old Testament, making him visible. Hebrews 1:3 says he is the exact representation of his being. So Jesus is how we get to know God. The fullness of God in Jesus is how we get to know him. The fullness of God is displayed through the Son. The entirety of the being of God, the entirety of the character is reflected in Jesus the Son. Jesus fulfills the purposes of God marked out for himself, marked out for humanity, and he takes it all the way to the cross. So we see Jesus as the image of God. We also see Jesus as the agent and creator and sustainer of all things. This is what the next few verses say. For everything was created by him in heaven and on earth, the invisible and the visible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and by him all things hold together. So let me continue. He's also the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. Firstborn, as we see it, typically means physically he's the first person born in a lineage. But as it's reflected in the Bible, in the Old Testament and New alike, it has to do with rank. It has to do with order. It has to do with supreme over all of creation, priority over all of creation. He's the agent of creation. It says he was there in the process, and he was actually the one who created all things. He made everything, owns all things, is sovereign over all things. He stamps everything in creation with mine. It's mine. It belongs to me. Everything was created through him for him, by him, holds together because of him. He's the sustainer to prevent chaos, to prevent the world from just spinning completely out of control. It all holds together because of him. Chaos that we see in the world today, COVID, racism, wars, all of those kinds of things. Jesus is still in control. Jesus is still Lord over all of those things. Scripture time and time again references his authority over creation, his authority over religion, his authority over life, his authority over heaven, over earth, over nature, over kingdoms, over demons, over sickness, over all things, and the authority to forgive sin. So he is the agent of creation, he's the sustainer of that creation, and he has authority, he's sovereign over all things. Then Paul shifts gears a little bit and starts talking about Jesus as the one to reconcile all things, as the one to bring things back into the way they were meant to be. Starting in verse 20, it says this, through him to reconcile everything to himself, whether things on earth or heaven or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. Once you were alienated and hostile in your minds, expressed in your evil actions, but now he has reconciled you by his physical body through his death to present you holy, faultless, and blameless before him. If indeed you remain grounded and steadfast in the faith and are not shifted away from the hope of the gospel that you heard. This gospel has been proclaimed in all creation under heaven, and I, Paul, have become a servant of it. So Jesus is the reconciler of all things. Everything that was in rebellion against God is now going to be brought under his power, is now going to be brought under his authority, is now going to submit to him as the head of the new creation. He's the agent of creation. He's the head of the new creation. All creation needs reconciliation. All creation spinning wildly out of control. Humanity was made for fellowship with God, but it's gotten out of order. It's spoiled with God. Things with God have become spoiled through sin and through things like that. Paul also references this idea of reconciliation over in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. It says this, everything is from God who has reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them. And he has committed the message of reconciliation to us. He made the one who did not know sin to be sin for us so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. All things are being reconciled. All things are being brought into a right relationship with God. All things are being brought out of rebellion and into rightness because of Jesus and ultimately because of his finished work on the cross. We were alienated from God. We were corrupt in our thinking. We were immoral in our behavior. We were estranged from God. But reconciliation makes us holy. It presents us pure and blameless before him. And the idea here is what the Old Testament sacrificial system refers to, where something blameless, something spotless, something pure had to be brought to God. Everything is now brought to God through Jesus, perfect, spotless, blameless, like the Old Testament sacrificial system. Everything's brought before him, submitted to him as the head of the new creation. We're separated from God, and now the finished work of Christ brings us back into relationship with God. It's kind of like the Old Testament temple court system. In the Old Testament temple courts, there was an outer range that only certain people could get to. And then there was a next level that only certain other people could get to. And a next level that only certain other people could get to. And ultimately, this final level that called the Holy of Holies, that only the high priest and only once a year under extreme circumstances could get to. And it's the same idea. Access to God that was not ours before is now ours because of Jesus, because of the work of Christ. Jesus is the one who starts us on the journey. Jesus is the one who gets us to the end of the journey. Trying to take control on our own, trying to take that control back on our own, is like saying to an airline pilot, I got this, I'll take it from here, thanks, and then jumping out of the rear exit. We should submit to him. He's sovereign. He is Lord over all. He is supreme over all, and he gives us access to bring us right before God, to bring us back into relationship with God. So that's the third thing that we see in this passage in Colossians. The final few verses of Colossians 1 kind of deal with Paul's call, Paul's ministry, as he explains his call to proclaim Christ. He explains his call to teach and to toil for Christ and for the gospel. Here's what he says. Now I rejoice in my sufferings for you, and I am completing in my flesh what is lacking in Christ's affliction for his body. That is the church. I have become its servant according to God's commission that was given to me for you to make the word of God fully known, the mystery hidden for ages and generations but now revealed to his saints. God wanted to make known among the Gentiles the glorious wealth of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. We proclaim him, warning and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone mature in Christ. I labor for this, striving with his strength that works powerfully in me. So Paul says that his call, kind of like the old song, is to rescue the perishing, care for the dying. He's a servant. He's called by God to be a servant of God, to proclaim the gospel, and he's willing to face persecution, willing to face suffering, willing to do all of that because he's encouraged by the hope that he has in Christ. He says it's a privilege to share in the suffering of Christ. It identifies him with his Lord to suffer with and for him. He rejoices in his suffering because it benefits the church and it benefits the spread of the gospel. His role, he says, is to proclaim Christ. It's to make the message known to the Gentiles and to help them see that the mystery is now being revealed through Christ, through Paul's message to them. This is a passage, or an idea rather, that Paul also references in the book of Ephesians. In Ephesians 3, verses 4 through 6, he says this, or 3 through 6. The mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have briefly written above. By reading this, you are able to understand my insight into the mystery of Christ. This was not made known to people in other generations, as it is now revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. The Gentiles are co-heirs, members of the same body, partners in the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. So he's referencing the same idea here. There's mystery revealed through Christ that Paul is a part of helping to reveal. Paul is commissioned by God himself to serve. He's commissioned to warn people. He's commissioned to proclaim the mystery of the gospel. He says he does it under no authority of his own, no power of his own, no message of his own. He does it at great personal cost, and he took it seriously. 2 Corinthians 11 talks about all the suffering, all the persecutions that Paul faced, and he says that it's worth it. He was flogged. He was starved. He was in prison. He was shipwrecked. He was beaten. So many different things he took on himself because of the call that he had in Christ. He also refers to himself in 2 Corinthians 5:21 as an ambassador for Christ, a representative of Christ. Again, not through his own strength, but through the strength of Christ in him. And then finally, as he wraps this section up, he says Christ in us is the hope of glory. That's the mystery revealed, that Christ in us, Christ dwelling in us, Christ taking residence in us is a privilege now. Emmanuel, God with us, the very name of Jesus, he's present in us. He's dwelling among his people. He is the hope of glory. He is our future confidence that Christ will take us all the way. Christ in us is our hope of glory, is that mystery revealed. And Paul says continuously that it's worth it, that the sufferings that he faces are worth the call that he has on his life because of Christ. And it should be for us as well. He says he labors and toils. He works hard as a committed athlete, as a committed soldier, as a committed, all of these things, all whatever imagery helps make that real to you. Paul is willing to do that. He's willing to work hard. He's willing to labor and toil for the gospel. I want to close tonight by sharing a story. A blind woman in Africa came to know the Lord at 70 years old. She was uneducated, didn't know how to read. She was blind. She became a Christian, and she wanted to do something for Christ. So she had a missionary who spoke French, underlined John 3:16 in her Bible, and she sat in front of a boy's school and had them read it to her in French. She would point out this. She said, "Can you read this to me in French?" And so they read it to her, and she asks them if they know what it means. And over time, as she explains what John 3:16 means to them, 24 of those boys not just became believers, but became pastors due to her influence, due to her work. Jesus changed her. Jesus changed Paul. And the hope that Jesus used to change her and to change Paul can change us and be used to change others. So the question for us is, will we allow him to be what Paul describes? Will we allow him to do what he desires? As we close tonight, we would have opened tonight with "Is He Worthy," which is a phenomenal passage, or phenomenal worship song rather, about Jesus. We would have closed with "Jesus Paid It All," talking about what he's done for us. Both tie into this message so well. We would have prayed for the Saeed people of Bangladesh. We would have prayed for Dale Huntington, a friend of mine who's a missionary in San Diego. So I want to take a moment to do that and just to pray for all of us as well. Father, I thank you for the Saeed people in Bangladesh. I pray that the gospel would be made known to them and that they would come to know the hope that it is Christ, the mystery that is Christ in us, revealed to us, and that it would change them and they would be used to change others. I pray for Dale. I thank you for the work he's doing on the front lines there in San Diego, that he's doing in the heart of the city with homeless people, with inner city, with all of the things that you're doing through him. And I thank you for him and his friendship, and I pray that you would continue to use him and sustain him even through this COVID mess. God, I pray for all of us that you would change us, and that because Jesus has changed us, that change would be revealed and proclaimed to those around us so that they can be changed and you can use us to change others because of Jesus, because of who he is, the wonderful story of who he is. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you guys for being a part of this. Love you guys. Hope to see you soon.